There's a part of the Pacific Ocean known as Melanesia. There are a bunch of islands here, and in the 1940s and 50s, the native tribes who inhabited these islands would do something strange. They would make what looked like a long runway, like what you see in airports, with fires using wooden torches along the sides of the runway so that it was visible from the sky at night, and they would put up a wooden hut with a man inside wearing what looked like wooden headphones with bars of bamboo sticking out like antennas. This was supposed to be the control room of the airstrip, and they would wait for airplanes to land, but no plane landed, obviously. But why would they go to all this trouble? In the early and mid-1940s, during World War II, the Pacific Islands were the grounds for multiple air and sea battles, and many countries had their military stationed in these islands. And the islanders saw multiple airplanes delivering cargo and supply to their soldiers. They landed on the same kinds of runways. And the islanders' reasoning was that if they built what looked like a viable airstrip, the planes would land there as well and bless them with cargo, which they imagined to be gifts from their gods or their ancestors. Now, why am I talking about this? And how is this story relevant to Hinduism? Is it the part about the gifts from their gods and ancestors? Nope, not at all. Then what's the relation? Oh, there's a strong one. My name's Pranav, you're watching Science is Dope. Let's begin. The story about the Melanesian Islanders was part of a speech given by the famous physicist Richard Feynman in Caltech in 1974. He used this analogy to describe what he called cargo cult science, a kind of pseudoscience that performs all the motions of real science, has all the appearance of real science, but achieves no result. In the minds of the tribe's people, they're doing everything right. But for some reason, the planes aren't landing. But talk to anyone with the slightest idea of how planes work or how radio communication works, and they can immediately tell you what's wrong. But if someone with no idea of these things looks at what the elders are doing, they'll see nothing wrong and wonder to themselves, hey, why aren't the planes landing? When you're online from India, or anywhere on an internet forum like Reddit, or even a YouTube comment section, you'll come across this notion that Hinduism is the most scientific religion in the world. Anyone who has studied any science discipline, or just paid attention in basic school level science, would not only be able to tell you what is wrong with this, but would probably laugh at the notion. You know why? Because they only have the appearance of real science. And in reality, there's no science in it whatsoever. It's all cargo cult science. Not all, but most of it is. And that's the relation between Hinduism and these Melanesian Islanders. Take almost any idea in this genre of scientific Hinduism that you've heard, and you'll be able to spot the similarity between that idea and what the cargo cult islanders were doing. Take the notion of the distance between the sun and the earth, which was apparently measured with no need for a telescope or math or trigonometry. The final value is just there in a religious worship book, the Hanuman Chalisa. There's a verse that says Yuga Sahasra Yojan, which is apparently 12,000 years times the number 1,000 times 8 miles, and that gives you the final answer, which is only a few percent off from the modern value. Someone tell me how time into distance equals distance? This is a perfect example of cargo cult science, the appearance of science without any actual science. Now, why do I give so much importance to science? Is it because I think that anything that science says has to be true? Do I treat science like my religion, like many religious folk like to accuse me of? No, it's because science works through the scientific method. Science finds evidence for something and concludes what it says from that. Sure, it can be wrong, but it's got these error correction mechanisms built within it, which is the topic for another video. But evidence is something you need before you can conclude something is true or something is consistent with reality. When religious folk come and give me some creation, I'd ask, why do you believe that's true when you have no evidence for it? I'll tell you where religious folk get their evidence. Like in this case with the Hanuman Chalisa, where did they get the precise value for the distance between the sun and the earth if they had no evidence for it? I'll tell you by the end of this video. The other day, I was watching a video by the popular math channel 3Blue1Brown on how Kepler used math and trigonometry to figure out the shape of orbits of planets. And I was so impressed by the authenticity and the ingenuity of the math involved. The only people this idea of Hindu science seems to impress are the devout followers of the religion, but never someone who's learned the actual science, learned how to measure distances in space, the distance from the Earth to a star or something. If only someone clarifies this whole thing in a quick 10-minute video. Oh, guess what? I've already done that in this video right here. I've gone into detail on how we use the parallax method and how we measure the distances in space. Another very common thing you see is that the idea of Darwin's evolution is present in the order of Vishnu's avatars. There was water life, and then reptiles, and then mammals, and then humans. First of all, Darwin never said this. What he proposed was a mechanism for how life presently evolved on the planet. He proposed the idea of natural selection for how life evolves on Earth from evidence. One of the inferences or conclusions from that idea is the idea of common descent or common ancestry or whatever you might like to call it. The only people who openly endorse this idea are the ones who know nothing about evolution.
Darwin's theory of evolution is only 152 years old. Adiyogi spoke about this over 15,000 years ago.
And the only people who believe it, let alone feel pride in it, are the followers of the religion who might think to themselves, hey, look at this, my team already got this right. Cargo cult science. I've done a detailed video on this if you're interested. There are other such ideas like the Shivlingas radioactive idea, which was started by conspiracy theorists, or the idea of Vimanas, which a lot of Hindus claim their ancestors flew in, or how famous scientists endorse Hinduism, or apparent medical sciences like Ayurveda. These are all examples of cargo cult sciences. I've got an entire playlist of these videos up on the channel, which you can watch after you watch this video. Now let's talk about how religious folk come up with the evidence needed when they have to portray such precise values. Easy. They just wait for modern science to discover that value and then backtrack and then say, look, if you solve this equation, you'll get the answer. And our ancestors knew this hundreds of years back. They'll never discover anything themselves. Only their ancestors knew how to discover things thousands of years back. And they'll come and tell us today about all that. So one example for this is that humans never knew about the idea of radioactivity until the late 1800s. But once it was discovered, here come the Hindus to bask in the glory. This is what all religious folk do. They wait for modern science to come up with the answer and say, look, we knew this all along. One thing we need to ask ourselves is, why are people motivated to think this way? The answer is confirmation bias. It's a way that humans tend to think that reinforces what they already believe. When the followers of a religion hold certain beliefs. Now, here's someone saying that their beliefs are scientifically validated. They're like, yes, I knew what I believed. I knew my religion was right all along. And I say this in a generalized manner because this is true of all religions, not just Hinduism. For example, in Islam, they say that the science of embryology is described in some vague verses that talk about the fetus in the womb. And there's an entire theory that Christians claim is scientific called intelligent descent, which they use to deny evolution. It's this whole idea about how God created the animals on Earth rather than them evolving from a common ancestor. These are all examples of cargo cult sciences. By the way, have you noticed how one religion is trying hard to deny evolution while another religion is completely in agreement with it? It's just hilarious to me how religious folk are really logical and rational when it comes to scrutinizing someone else's religion, but fail to use the same reason and logic and rationality to scrutinize their own religion. Feel free to share this video with people who you think might need it. And if you'd like to support me in other ways, I've provided links for that below. I'd like to thank my highest tier Patreon and YouTube members who support me. And by the way, here's that playlist of videos of topics that Hinduism claims to be scientific. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.